前发家前我那边的人种植房子了，但是那个家有萝卜松子种的地方，这也是开发家中的居民房子，在那里租金呢就被不能动的房子拒绝出租，在这儿的人家有七八栋房子在上头。那上头人家的话就有，这家就在老北京老了，他们几个满意的老了，身体上去自然充满了满意的，就在那上头上去的航空马上就发的，家就在老北京都才有上的，你讲究的当然不高。
We have learned that the first part.That part of Muhammad al-Akbar which we received instructions from him is the going for refuge or placing ourselves under the protection of the three rare and precious ones which are none other but the Buddha, the Dharma and the Sangha, and how having done that we give rise to the enlightened attitude. Now if we take refuge in this way, we place ourselves under their protection in this way, we would imagine these three sources of protection and refuge to be truly present in front of us in space.To that end, we imagine how truly before us appears the Buddha, who is the source of all of these teachings, surrounded by the community of all the realized and enlightened beings, the Bodhisattvas. We imagine how the Dharma is present in the form of their awakened hearts, awakened awareness, and in this way we go for refuge. We wholeheartedly place ourselves under their protection.When we do so, however, we do not just imagine this for ourselves alone. We imagine to be surrounded by all sentient beings. We imagine to do this for all beings who at one time or other invariably have been our loving and kind mothers and fathers. So with this thought at heart, with this wish at heart, we then place ourselves under the protection of these three sources of refuge.
to go out. He was on to the Sangamo, Sanjay Bata, Sanjay Tandi, Hama Shaga, Sanjaya Shaga Ye. And then Sanjay Tandi, Tata Four, the Hungry Tommy, and Koronko, and Mari Pare, only on the two young dog, the Missy. They laughed in it, and then Sanjay Tandi, Tuma Tandi, Tower and Dead.
Well, having taken refuge in this way, you now proceed to give rise to the so-called enlightened attitude, or that which we commonly know as bodhicitta. We remind ourselves of the fact that there is not a single being in the world that has not, one time or another, been of living incarnate mind. All of these beings, not a single one included, have been our minds and at this time have shown us great kindness. However, presently they find themselves under the influence of great ignorance and they do not know what it takes to break out of this cycle of suffering. Whatever they do does not bring about the end of suffering in any which way. Therefore, in order to bring about their swift and lasting enlightenment, awakening, in order to assist them in this way, we then give rise to that attitude that we ourselves may be able to do so. We may be able to bring about the lasting benefit of all of these beings who have invariably been our mothers at one time or other. And with this thought at heart, with this thought reminding ourselves of this, we should contemplate this a little bit.
Lama,
second part from among the five parts of Mahamudra is the practice that is known as the meditation upon one's teaching, which is so-called Guru Yoga. It is an efficient means for those who have not yet glimpsed the true nature of their own minds, of their own consciousness, in order to bring that glimpse about. And it is an efficient means for those who have already done so to receive the blessing and inspiration of their gurus, which is necessary in order to progress in their practice. Therefore, to pray to one's guru in this way, to concentrate oneself upon one's own personal main teacher, receive blessing and inspiration from him, for that matter, in this way, this is the practice of the Guru Yoga. In this way, this is to be performed by us as the second step, second part, the five parts of Guru Yoga. In order to now receive the blessing and inspiration of our root guru, we imagine how our root guru appears above our heads in the shape of His Holiness the 17th Dalai Lama, Dorje. To that end, we imagine how above our heads there appears a precious throne. This throne is being supported by eight lions. On top of that throne, there is a thousand petal lotus flower, on top of which there is a sun disk, on top of which rests a moon disk. And on top of this seat sits the root teacher of ours in the shape of the Kamapa. Upon his head he wears a black crown, which is ornamented with gold. He holds his two hands crossed in front of his head, holding a vajra in his left hand, in his right hand, and holding a bell in his left hand. He is clothed in the so-called three dharma robes, and his legs are in the cross position. In this way, he sits above our head, radiating in all his splendor, and this way we imagine our teacher to appear as the Kamapa above ourselves. Imagining our own teacher above our heads in the shape of the Kamapa, we appreciate the fact that appearing in this shape, he is the essence of all the Buddhas. He is the essence of all the other enlightened beings, of all the bodhisattvas and all other spiritual things. Similarly, he is the essence of all teaching, of all dharma, and he is at the same time the essence also of all Gidam deities. Because at the same time, again, he is the essence of all the guardians and protectors of the dharma. In one word, he is the essence of everything that is good and wholesome in this world. Imagining our main teacher in the shape of the Kamapa as that, we now turn towards that teacher, towards the Kamapa, and we pray to him that we ourselves and all other sentient beings, not a single one excluded, may now receive his blessing and inspiration. Now let us train in this right now.
Come on.
kama pa so wa te te du pa be kama pa ta re ni re re ka mo tu a ro ko ta wa la ta ne te de de ba do wa pa ko yo sa la ko kama pa dum ba ne re se ma ko tu a ro ko dum ba la ta pa re de ba do wa pa kama pa so ni sa la kama pa to ka ne re se tin ka a ro ko tin ka la ta
Having in this way prayed to the Kamapa, one quantity, we now imagine how from the forehead of the Kamapa, white light radiates. Souls into our own forehead. In this way, all the negativity, all the obscurations, all everything negative that has ever been permitted by way of our bodies is being purified, and we receive the blessing and inspiration of the body of the Kamapa. Then, from his throat, red light radiates, dissolving into our own throat. In this way, all the negativity and obscurations that we have ever permitted or brought about with our speech is being purified, and blessing and inspiration of the Kamapas in Latin speech. Then from his heart region, deep blue light radiates, dissolving into our own heart, and in this way, all the negativity, the obscuration, emotional defilements within our mind streams are being completely purified, and we receive blessing and inspiration of the enlightened awareness of the Kamapa. Then, simultaneously, from his forehead, throat, and heart, white, red, and blue light radiates and melts into our own foreheads, throats, and hearts, and all the negativity, obscurations, emotional defilements that have appeared by way of simultaneous activity of our bodies, speeches, and minds is being completely purified and eradicated, and we receive the inspiration and blessing of the enlightened awareness of the Kamapa in such a way, and we can be sure that at this moment we have then received the inspiration that will eventually lead to our realization of Mahamudra itself. Having imagined this, we then imagine how the Kamapa above our heads completely dissolves into light and melts into ourselves. So this way, our body, speech, and mind become completely inseparable from the body, speech, and mind, Latin body, speech, and mind of the Kamapa. Having done that, we then simply rest in this awareness, free of any hope for improvement or fear of deterioration. Now concerning Guru Yoga practice, one should know that there is a great many different ones. There are extremely concise ones, there are slightly more elaborate ones, and there are very elaborate ones. If one should wish to practice one of these elaborate practices, then within our own tradition, we would practice the one which is the most important of these elaborate ones, which is composed by Eighth Kamapa and meditation upon the Eighth Kamapa, which is known as the Guru Yoga in Four Sessions.
Then you put sporong re ka la thain ke ane nga du re ka la thain ke ane se du re ka la thain ke ane ta mo mai ro ka du se re ka la thain ke thain ye re ka la nyang se le du ti la ma du ko la na ni de ane du so da ni ke na me ke ti da ti de thain ye la ma na du se se ke li ti ba.
Now, why is this particular Guru Yoga called the Guru Yoga in four sessions? This particular type of Guru Yoga practice involved in the time of the, in the time of the seventh Kamapa, the eighth Kamapas, as well as Kamapas before and after. These Kamapas were known to travel a great deal, and as was the custom at that time, they would travel in great encampments. Wherever they would stay, they would pitch tents. Kamapa and other teachers would give Dharma instructions to the students who had gathered around them, and all of these students, lay disciples, would then pitch their own tents in the surrounding areas and then go and practice that particular teaching as they had received. Now, it was the custom at that time that they would practice four times a day, particularly also this Guru Yoga. The first session would be practiced from daybreak until the early morning hours. There would be a second session which would be sometime in the morning before noon, there would be a third session in the afternoon, and then the fourth and final session would be practiced after sundown. So in this way, four sessions were practiced, four meditation sessions were performed. This kind of Guru Yoga practice was performed in this way, and this particular one therefore has this name, Guru Yoga, in four sessions. Now it is entirely possible that we students occasionally might have some time and even the wish to do a little bit more intensive practice. We might do so for a couple of days, for 5 days or 3 days or other durations, and we might want to do intensive practice during these times. So that we are able to use this Guru Yoga practice, this particular one, to perform it during such periods of time, I've just decided to explain this particular one to us.
The actual liturgy for the text that was just to be recited for that Guru Yoga was composed by the eighth Kamapa himself. The instruction manual, which includes all the various steps that have to be meditated during this practice, for this particular instruction manual was composed by the first Chan. And Kamachagma starts out the instruction manual on the Guru Yoga four sessions by way of paying homage to the Kamapa. He prostrates to the Guru Kamapa and says that the Kamapa is in essence the same as or no different from the great compassionate Bonhomme, the Teshwara or Chambezi, as we know him. He goes on to say that according to the annals of Lama Shang, Yudrapa, as he was known, the eight manifestations of the Kamapa, from the first Kamapa Dusan Tempa down to the present, at Kamachagma's time, present eighth Kamapa, that these eight Kamapas are in essence no different from the eight manifestations of Guru Pratisamapa or Guru Rinpoche. In this way, because this is so, the eighth Kamapa Nipindorje has composed this particular Guru Yoga. This is what Kamachagma says, based on the information that was handed down in the writings of Lama Shang. At the time of the ninth Karmapa, Wangchuk Dorje, there was yet another Lama whose name was Yangri Trungpa Sunamthang. This Lama requested an explanation on the, an instruction manual on the Guru Yoga in four sessions, which the eighth Karmapa, the previous Karmapa, had composed. And indeed, the ninth Karmapa, Wangchuk Dorje, composed such a manual, which is extremely long and elaborate indeed. Now, the first Kamachagma Rinpoche, who is the author of this considerably shortened version, considered the ninth Karmapa's instruction manual to be far too long and too elaborate to be practicable for ordinary practitioners like ourselves. This long and deliberate instruction manual contains instructions on Mahamudra practice, on the six doctrines of Naropa, and so forth, and it goes into all kinds of conceivable details. Therefore, in order to make things easier for ordinary practitioners like ours, Karma Chakma set out to compose a much shorter, less elaborate instruction manual, and this is the present one that we have here. Having said this, Kamachakma then proceeds to explain what is to be done during the practice. The practice starts out by way of praying to the four bodies, or four enlightened bodies, or kayas of the of one's guru, of the teacher. And we start out with this prayer, which begins with the words, all sentient beings, my mothers, whose numbers are as vast, are as limitless as space is vast, pray to the essence body of the teacher, this the Bhavika Kaya. All of us, all of these beings, and so forth, pray to the enlightened awareness of the Buddha, which is of the teacher, which is the Dharma Kaya. All of these beings, and so forth, pray to the enlightened speech of the teacher, which is the Sambhoga Kaya, and finally, pray to the body or the activity, which is the manifestation of the compassion of the teacher as the Nirmanaka. So in this way, we pray to the four enlightened aspects, the four enlightened kayas or Buddhas of the teacher. We start out the practice with this recitation. A short while ago, we received a phone call that is evidence in the neighborhood, which will arrive here at 4 o'clock or thereabouts. Since it's already 3:30, Rinpoche would like to close here for today. So, therefore, let us finish this teaching session for this afternoon and let us now dedicate the merit that has been accumulated for the sake of beings and then go outside the village.